Mr. Wallach, how did your role in Baby Doll come about?
Well, I'd worked with Tennessee in several of his plays, in The Rose Tattoo and Camino Real. And Kazan had this idea that he was afraid to handle fantasy. He had done a play called The Skin of Our Teeth. So he picked a little scene from Camino Real by Tennessee Williams. I was in a play called Mr. Roberts with Henry Fonda, playing a sailor. And Kazan said, I want to rehearse a little scene and show it to Tennessee. So I rehearsed with him, and it was a scene from a play called Camino Real, where I played a young sailor. And Tennessee saw the play and said, we showed it to him, one scene. And he said, he'll be very good to be in The Rose Tattoo. And that's how I got in The Rose Tattoo. But the play that we rehearsed, Camino Real, always stuck in Tennessee's mind and in Kazan's mind. And they asked me to play that role. So I played it. Now came Baby Doll. And Kazan remembered that I had turned down a movie before in order to play Camino Real. Camino Real lasted about 3 months, less than that. The actor who played it became world famous, or was, won the Academy Award. His name was Frank Sinatra. So Kazan, remembering that I turned the play down, the movie down, offered me Baby Doll, and that's how I did it.
And how was the play changed for the screen?
The play, there were 2 one-act plays by Williams. One is called The Unsatisfactory Supper, and the other is called 27 Wagonful of Cotton. So he combined them into Baby Doll. In the play, Baby Doll weighs about 230 pounds. But Kazan had an idea. He wanted a baby doll, literally. So he got Carol Baker. And Carl Malden was to play Mian, whatever his name is. And I was to play the cotton gin operator. My name was Silver Vaccaro. And Carl said to me, Eli, this is your first movie. And do you realize that on the screen your head is about 30 feet high? So don't open your mouth too much, because they'll see your tonsils and your inlays. So I had a shot in the film where I appeared at the top of a flight of stairs, and Carol, Baby Doll, said, Hi-o, Silver. And I said, Hi-o. And Kazan said, say it. I said, I did. Hi-o. He said, no, open your mouth and say it. I said, Hi-o. He said, I don't want the Japanese version. I want you to speak. Oh, he said, Carl Malden has been at you. Because Carl was telling me about my head. But that was the way I had my baptism in movie making.
And picking up with Mr. Kazan, how did he work with you as a director?
Well, he always caused conflict. A play comes alive when there's conflict. So he'd say to me, go on stage and make friends. I don't know, each person does it differently. Then he'd tell all the other actors, don't have anything to do with him. He's got bad breath. He's not a very nice person, so on. So I'd come on and say, where's the Western Union? And the other character would go, pfft. And I thought, oh, well, it's the game and we have to play it. But that's the way he'd do it. However, he allowed the actor to run on his path as he saw it. Strange thing happens in the theater. The first reading you have, it takes 3 weeks of rehearsal to get back to that naked first reading, unprepared, unrehearsed. And that's what's remarkable about acting. So Kazan did let you go. I used to say to him, he'd say, print 1 and 2, or print 1 and 4. And I say, can I do one more, because I have another idea. He say, sure, we have a lot of film. And every time I asked, he never printed it, which was his way of saying, I'm the objective eye out there. Don't you edit yourself. Just play the scene, play the situation. If you're angry, you don't have to be angry. We were all steeped in the method which took was The Rage in the late 40s. And it was like we had discovered a new religion. No one else mattered. No one else had any skill at whatever they were doing because we had the answer to all great acting. And we were impossible. Impossible. Stuffy, sure of ourselves. I remember an old actor. I came off stage in a play where I was doing with Eva Le Gallien, written by Shaw, called Androcles and the Lion. I came off stage and I said to this wonderful old actor, gee, I get a great laugh there. He said, you do? I said, yes. The next performance, I didn't get the laugh, which was his way of saying to me, don't be so sure. You don't have the answer to everything. There are other people on the stage with you.
Yeah, I mentioned the method, and I was wondering if you could describe method acting to a non-actor. How would you go about explaining it?
There are a million methods. New York is filled with acting schools and teachers. Each one has adapted it to their own insights. What I would say to a young actor, trust yourself. When you were a little boy and you played, the radiator was hot and you were warming your hands, it's always the adult who says, that's not a real stove. You say, I know, I'm making believe. That's what I'm doing. Well, as you grow older, you begin to discard all those wonderful insights that you had as a little boy. And the method, a method, tends to put you back on the track to enjoy what you're doing, to listen. The big secret in acting is listening. A thought on the screen is amazing. And if you really listen, it comes to life. There are all kinds of theories about how to approach it. I don't know. Bertolt Brecht wrote a thing called The Old Hat about an actor who keeps trying on hats. He's dissatisfied. He winds up, he says, I think I'll have a little toothbrush sticking out of this pocket because that may show that I'm unsure of myself, I don't have a place to live, and it tells more than all the acting I can do. So acting is a great mystery.
You were involved early on with the early stages of the Actors Studio.
Yeah.
As a founding member?
Yes.
So what was it like to be involved with that at its early stages?
I told you, we were all impossible. It was started in 1947. There were two groups. Kazan had one, and Bobby Lewis had another, and a woman named Cheryl Crawford. The three of them put it together. In the 30s, there was the group theater. Bunch of actors who decided to defy the old methods around. Most plays took place in drawing rooms and Noel Coward and so on. These plays of Clifford Odets and Sidney Kingsley dealt with the people, the people, the working people. So they died, the group died in 1941. In 1947, these three people, Bobby Lewis, Cheryl Crawford, and Kazan, got together and said, let's regenerate, take actors who are working in the theater and give them a place where they can work out on scenes they would normally not do. I could play Hamlet with Mildred Dunnick in the closet scene of Hamlet, which I wouldn't normally get a chance to do. It was like a gymnasium or a workout place. And I enjoyed that. And it's still going. Now, Paul Newman is president emeritus, Al Pacino, Estelle Parsons, Harvey Keitel. There are many, many, many actors who are all still going at it, still doing scenes. A month ago, I did a scene with my youngest daughter, Catherine, from Moon for the Misbegotten. I played an Irish drunk father, and she played my daughter. And it was wonderful going back up on stage with my youngest daughter.
Sounds like a great experience. We also had Phoebe Brand earlier today, and she spoke to us about the group theater.
Oh, yes.
So it was wonderful hearing about that.
And her husband, Morris Karnofsky.
Yes. Spoke about his films. Before I leave Kazan and also Baby Doll, I wanted to ask you if you could comment on the controversy in that film with the Legion of Decency and the notoriety.
Well, I think it was attacked as being the most pornographic movie ever created. Time magazine said, first it was Cardinal Spellman said, this film is, if you see it, you're in danger, if you're a Catholic, of committing a sin and being excommunicated. They asked him if he'd seen the movie. He said, no. If the water supply is poisoned, I don't drink the water. So I thought it was a rather biblical movie because it dealt with revenge. And it was done innocently. Time magazine said this is the most pornographic movie ever made. It was so disgusting that it would even make Boccaccio blush. It was a Priapian something. And I rushed to the dictionary to find out what the hell Priapian was. I won't tell you, go look it up. But it made my hair stand up. I didn't know I was engaged in Priapian pursuits.
And how does Hollywood change plays?
Change plays?
Yes, and I think you had mentioned a few already. The Rose Tattoo, you were in Mr. Roberts on the stage, and the film version of Mr. Roberts did not have you in the cast. You know,
well, that's that was normal for the time. Mm-hmm. A movie script, an original script written for the movies, what they usually say is, after the first reading, let's get the rewrite. Let's bring someone else in. And there are usually three or four chefs making the one meal. In the theater, believe it or not, the playwright is king or queen. Because you cannot change one word on the stage of a play. You can't say, I just felt differently. I didn't want to say it. You can't do that. In movies, you stick to the script, but it's been written by four or five other people. So the insights, the invention of the playwright, the original playwright, is often distorted, weakened, watered, and it doesn't come out well.
Mr. Wallach, why is that done, in your opinion, that Hollywood would recast a play in the movie version?
Well, let's take the classic example. Julie Andrews spent 3 years playing My Fair Lady. Now, it would be normal to assume that she would do the film. However, the film studios have people under contract who are much better known at the time, so they got Audrey Hepburn to play it. And a lot of actors, Burt Lancaster and Rosalind Russell, used to buy plays for themselves so that they could bypass the studios and have the property for themselves. I did The Rose Tattoo on Broadway, and when it was bought by Burt Lancaster, who did it with Anna Magnani, who was fearful about doing it on the stage. It was written for her, but she did it in the movies. So that's the way it happens. The studios have their program of how they want to cast a film, and it doesn't matter who plays it and how often they play it on the stage. They don't get the job. Oh, I was telling that story, Joshua Logan.
Logan, Director Logan?
Yes. He said, he came as a moderator at the Actors Studio, and he said, I'd like some of you actors maybe direct a play, and I chose a one-act play by Tennessee called Hello from Bertha. And I rehearsed. I cast Maureen Stapleton and my wife and Margaret Phillips. I came in front of the curtain after rehearsals and I said to all the actors there with Logan, I said, I chose this play because I'm interested in prostitution. And they laughed. And I said, seriously, during the war, I was a medical administrative officer. And one of my jobs was to raid whorehouses all over North Africa. I became an expert in venereal diseases, syphilis and gonorrhea. Our job was to preserve and protect the life of our soldiers. I said, now the play. And Mr. Logan said, to hell with the play, go on with the sex lecture. But he then cast me in Mr. Roberts.
Wow. And in your opinion, should plays be filmed?
I did a play with my wife called The Tiger and the Typist, two one-act plays. we filmed the tiger. In the play, there were just the two of us. I kidnapped a woman on the streets, took her to my basement apartment, and was going to rape her. In the movie, there were 38 people in the cast. The mailman, my friends, people here on the bus, and all that stuff. And what they do when they enlarge it from a play into a movie is they say, we'll enlarge it. And in enlarging it, a lot of the goodies fall out. The focus and the concentrated effort goes berserk. I did a play for almost over a year, called Visiting Mr. Green. We're trying to make it into a movie. About an old man who almost gets hit by a car, and the judge sentences the young man who almost hit him 6 months community service. He has to come to the house every Thursday and look after the old man. We're wondering how to open it up. Do we show the accident? Oh, it's so funny when the man discovers that the boy almost hit him in the house. So there's a danger. I think movies, a sigh, a yawn, a look can speak pages. Whereas on the stage, you have to, it's a verbal medium. The movies are here. The eyes, as Tennessee said, the eyes are the windows of the soul. And that's where a lot of it happens.
And speaking of Tennessee Williams, what do you want us to know about him?
About him?
Mm-hmm.
He took us on such wonderful journeys. Camino Real is a nightmare and a fantasy and an allegory. I'll never forget one of the final speeches in that play. And my wife and I have based our life on that quote. Lord Byron, in the play, is on his way to Greece. And he says, lately, I've been listening to hired musicians behind a row of artificial palm trees instead of the single pure stringed instrument of my heart. What is the heart but an instrument that turns chaos into order and noise into music? Make voyages, attempt them. There's nothing else. And our life is dedicated to the idea of making the voyages, attempting them. We fail. We fail a lot, but we still have the appetite to act. And that's what we do.
And I've read somebody describing you as a leading interpreter of Tennessee Williams. As an actor and doing a Williams play, how do you, his writing, you know?
Well, he's a poet. He's I tell you something, it's like finding a vein in a mine. It's gold. It's so wonderful to have that. The actor, a lot of times the actor gets credit for what this man dreamed up and created. So I've been most fortunate, and so has Anne, in finding and being able to work with wonderful material.
Now, how do you alter your acting from plays to a film?
Well, in the beginning, you know, when I started in the theater, there were no microphones. You had to give out. Whereas in the movies, stage actors tend to overdo. And don't remember what I said about listening. One of the secrets in good film acting is listening and not having to push. You can't say, oh, I'm going to shift gears. I'm going from the theater. When I went to make my first movie, Baby Doll, I was on leave of absence from a play called Tea House of the August Moon. I played an Okinawan, an Oriental. I played it for a year in London. I played it 9 months in New York. And then I got this offer to do Baby Doll. And the producers in New York said, you can't leave the show. I said, but it's my great opportunity. They said, well, how long will the movie take? I'd never made a film. So I said, 8 weeks. They said, all right, for each week in the movie, you have to add 2 weeks onto your contract. I said, all right, I'll do that. The movie took 13 weeks. Baby Doll. So I had to play another 26 weeks of the play. But I didn't miss it. I didn't feel bad about that. I was deliriously happy that I was going to play Tea House after Baby Doll.
Now, moving into another picture of yours, The Magnificent Seven.
Yes.
From 1960. What was it like on that set?
Well, I had seen the Japanese version, The Seven Samurai. It was a brilliant movie of Kurosawa. And I met with John Sturges, who was the director. He said, I want you to play the head bandit. I said, no, I want to play the Mifune character, the crazy samurai. I'd like to... No, no, he said, that's the love interest. I said, oh. I said, the head bandit, he just appears, he has an eye patch, and you see his horse's hoofs, and he rides in and rides out. He said, we'll build the part. So I couldn't figure out where they found me, how they knew I could ride a horse, and how was I going to play a Mexican bandit. So I dreamed up, this is where the method and the acting all came fused together. I thought in all Westerns, you see them hold up the bank, or they rob the train, or they steal the cattle. You never see what they do with the money. So I went to Sturges and I said, I want a red silk shirt. I'm going to put two gold caps on my teeth. I want a silver saddle and a beautiful horse. I want to show that this man who was a bandit, a head bandit, how he lived well. He said, fine, do that. And that's how I created the role of this man. I also said to him, he said, why do you type when you're riding a horse? I said, what do you mean type? He said, you hold the reins with this hand quite authoritatively, and this hand is going like this. I said, oh, and I'll stop typing. But I had to listen to the music. The music came in after the movie was finished. I said, if I had heard Elmer Bernstein's music, I would have ridden the horse differently.
How would you have?
Well, I would have sat up in the saddle, and the music was marvelous. In that, music is marvelous in movies. In the old days, in the silent movies, the actors, there was no sound. So they had an orchestra on the set to play sad music for sad scenes, happy music for happy scenes, and it sifts through the psyche of the actor, and he reacts accordingly.
There were a lot of big egos on the set of Magnificent Seven. How did Sturges handle all the actors?
I once stood alongside the camera while the seven of them were crossing the river. Each one did their little piece to... I think it was McQueen reached down with his hat and dipped into the water, or Ewell turned his gun a certain way. You know. But that was good. That was needed for it. But Ewell was the leader of those seven. And as the head bandit, I wasn't interested in any of them. I didn't compete. I was in control of my 35 bandits. We arrive in the morning, and the head wrangler, that's the man in charge of the horses, said to me, I want you to take your group and go for a ride for an hour. So we'd ride for an hour, 35 men with me, riding all over the, in Tepoztlan, a little Indian village. And I'd come back all dirty and sweaty, and we were ready to shoot. But I used to speak to the horse when I started any of these Westerns. I'd say, don't get smart, I'm from New York. And the horse would turn back and look at me, and oh God, I'm gonna spend 3 weeks with this one. But horses have to be, you have to control a horse. In Hollywood, the horses all know how to hit their marks, I played in Yugoslavia and Spain and Italy, and all the horses there are not trained.
I see. Now, what was your reaction when you saw the finished movie?
I liked the music at the beginning, and I rode in and I thought, first I initially didn't want to do the part. I thought, well, I come in and shoot somebody and ride out. For the next 35 minutes, all they talked about was me. I thought, oh, no, I think I will do this movie. Because they had a man on the set named El Indio. He was a Mexican director who, when he didn't like one of the critics' reviews of one of his movies, John Steinbeck's The Pearl shot the man, shot the critic. I don't know if that works anymore, but he was blacklisted. He couldn't work anymore, but they used him on the set to help. So he said to me, I take you now to Mexico City, and we get you a hat. You're head bandit. You have to have a hat, real hat. So we go. I get measured for the thing in Mexico City. He says, well, good, good. Now we go celebrate. And we went out, and we had tequila, and I don't remember the night. But the next morning, we went to get the hat, and I looked at it. It was the size of a cocktail table, this big. I said, El Indio, if I put that hat on and I ride the horse fast, I'll sail off the back of the horse. No, no, he said, it'll be all right. We arrived, and Sturgis said, let me see the hat. And he said, you're not going to wear that. Take the scissors, and they cut it down so that, like that.
The following year, you were cast in The Misfits. And what was that movie based on?
Arthur Miller went to Reno, Nevada to get a divorce. And he met people that was like from another planet. So he wrote an article, I think, for Saturday Evening, for Esquire, about his experience with these people and these men who were misfits. They didn't care about anything except the pursuit of enjoyment. So he wrote this story. And he cast it, Clark Gable, Marylin Monroe, Monty Clift, Thelma Ritter. And each one of the main characters in that, the main stars of that movie, were going outside the mold for which they were recognized. And the critics were disappointed because they dropped their persona from all the other movies. I mean, Gable was not like that in any other movie, nor was Marylin. And so, if you gamble, if you take chances in film, they don't like it very much. So that movie had great tensions in it, and John Huston was marvelous, wonderful director.
Were you cast for that role?
Well, I'd met Marylin when she came to New York in a contractual dispute, and I don't think she'd ever seen a play, but Cheryl Crawford, one of the producers of many plays, asked her to come and see Tea House. So she was amazed that you could do 2 hours on a stage with no microphones, no cameras, nothing. She said, can I come back and watch it? She'd stand in the wings. They allowed her to watch it. So, and we became quite friendly. She even babysat for our kids. So when the movie was being cast, she said, why don't you get him? And Arthur said, fine. So that's how I got the job.
Do your kids remember that they were once babysat by Marylin Monroe?
Well, Peter does. He's the oldest. He remembers.
Wow. How did that cast get along on the set?
Very well. Very well. Monty Clift and Marylin had this close relationship. They were like two sides of the same coin. Frightened. I don't want to go into the analysis of each of these. Gable was happy his wife was pregnant. She had lost a child, miscarried before, and now he was delighted. And he died 10 days after we finished the movie. He had a massive heart attack. And she had the baby. And I met the boy a year ago in California. He's 40 years old now, 41. His name is John Clark Gable. He's a racing car driver. He has Gable's smile and his physique. He's a young, good young man.
Wonderful. And how was Miss Monroe?
Miss Monroe was Miss Monroe. It was difficult for her to get to the set on time. It was not easy. There were tensions underneath that I don't want to go into. Things were happening. And she had a masseuse, and she had an acting coach, and Arthur. And I think Arthur and she were having their problems. But I don't want to go into that. But Marylin was amazing. You know, underestimated. I mean, everybody thought of the skirt blowing up on the over the subway in the 7-year itch. She once said, "I want to play Grushenka in The Brothers Karamazov." And everyone laughs. And they haven't read the book. They're not up to what I'm up to in terms of what I want to do. Don't forget, she left a secure career in Hollywood because she wasn't allowed to wander off the reservation. She wasn't allowed to play the role she thought she could play. If you see her performances in Gypsy, Bus Stop, or in what's the one with Jack Lemmon?
Some Like It Hot.
And in The Misfits, you'll see quite an actress.
And was The Misfits a success when it came out?
No.
Why not?
Basically, because as I said, I think that the three leading characters were outside the parameters of what they usually did in movies. They were taking chances, and the critics didn't. They thought the movie was overblown, and I don't know. You never know what's going to happen with a movie. You never know. Who would have thought? I'll go to my grave, and on it it'll say The Ugly. The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. That's a movie I had great fun doing because the director said, "I want all the lights to come like Vermeer." And I thought, isn't that great? All the lights in Vermeer's painting, I think he did 12 paintings, come from a window like that. And I thought, that's wonderful. He said to me, "I don't want you to carry a gun in a holster." I said, "Where do you want me to put it?" He said, "You have a rope around your neck." I said, "I know." "And the gun dangles between my legs?" He said, "Yes." "And when you want the gun, you twist your shoulders, I cut to your hand, there's the gun." I said, "Would you show me?" He put the rope around his neck. He weighed about 300 pounds. He twisted, it missed his hand, hit him in the groin. He said, "I tell you, keep it in your pocket. Just keep it in your pocket." And that's what I did for the rest of the movie.
And Mr. Wallach, director John Huston, who worked with you on The Misfits, what are your thoughts on him?
I thought he had great sense of movie making. Also, he's a writer. And he understands the medium. He understood the medium brilliantly. I thought he directed in a way by indirection. I had a scene with Clark Gable where I'm sitting there and we've had 6 drinks while Marylin is dancing with Monty Clift. And I was playing my drunkenness. And while they were relighting, he came over to me and he said, "You know the drunkest I ever was in my life?" I said, "No." He said, "Yesterday." I said, "Yesterday? I was with you all day." He said, "Yeah. He rode a camel in a race with a horse." He said, "That's the drunkest I ever was." They said, "We're ready to light," and he walked away, and I thought, a drunk doesn't say I'm drunk. A drunk tries to be as sober as possible. It's just that physically something is happening. And that's the way he directed, without saying to me, "Don't be so drunk." He just told me that yesterday he was so drunk, I didn't even notice it. So that's what I liked about him. Also, he's a scamp. He liked to pit people against people, as Kazan did. And he enjoyed storytelling. I told a story about his father, Walter Huston. When I was a kid going to school in Texas, I used to usher to see plays, and I'd put the seats down, and Walter Huston was in a play, and I ran out in the alley, and there he was smoking a cigarette in the intermission. And I said, "Mr. Huston, I'm an actor. I'm from New York, but I'm down here going to school, and I want to get into the theater." And he said, "We all do, kid, we all do." And he flipped the cigarette and walked away. And I told that story to John, who said, "Yeah, that's my pop." So John had genetically in him, built in, the theater.
Wow. Now, who directed you in How the West Was Won?
A man named Henry Hathaway, who has a reputation as being a tough, growly. And underneath, he was a marshmallow. But I had done a movie with him before called The Seven Thieves with Joan Collins and Eddie G. Robinson and Rod Steiger. So he called me up once and he said, I want you to do this movie. I'm directing one episode or two episodes of How the West Was Won. There are going to be three directors, John Ford, George Marshall, and me. I said, can I see the script? He said, sure. 2 days later, I got two pages. I said, I can't do this. It's only two pages, a scene on a train. He said, listen to me, you New York actor. It's going to take me 3 weeks to shoot those two pages. And when it's finished, the audience is going to be so moved, they're going to clap. I said, okay, I'll do it. And I said, only thing I want, I had lost my eyebrows from doing Tea House. I used to soap them and put makeup above it. I said, I need eyebrows. He said, what? I said, I need eyebrows. He said, okay, I'll get you. You can have eyebrows. Well, I had the biggest, strongest eyebrows and a big mustache, and I had a great time shooting those 3 weeks.
And, I'm sorry, who did you play, if you could talk about that train?
I played a guy named Charlie Gant, a bandit. Now, it was being shot in Cinerama or CinemaScope or whatever it was. It used to be three cameras. So if I'm playing a scene with you, I didn't look directly at you. I'd look here and say, how are you doing? Very well. It was a strange medium. I arrive with the train, and I take a suitcase and I'm to throw it out the window to my gang who is standing there. And I couldn't throw it directly at the man. I had to throw it here. He said, action. The train pulled in. I took the suitcase and threw it and hit the man, one of my gang, in the head and knocked him out. And Hathaway said, cut. You New York actors, you can't do anything right. Can't do anything right. But he did one fine, wonderful thing with me. When I was cast in The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, I went to him and I said, they want me to go and do a Western in Italy and Spain. I don't know what to wear. Can I make up the costume? He said, come with me. And we went to the Western Costume Company. And he found me chaps. Chaps are those leather things the cowboys wear, but only from the knees down. And he found me a straw hat with an eagle on it. And he just designed the costume for me right there. And I wore it all, partly through the movie.
Before moving on to The Good and Bad, the Ugly, I wanted to ask you, what did you think of the finished film of How the West Was Won?
I thought it was a remarkable kaleidoscopic story of the West, and beautifully done with a huge cast. James Stewart. The narrator was Spencer Tracy. Carol Baker, George Peppard. They were a huge cast. I enjoyed it.
And the train scene at the end with all that stunt work, you facing off with George Peppard,
yeah.
Do you have any memories of filming that?
Yes, days going back and forth on this train, you know. And I had to be shot. I think in the first seven movies I was killed five times. I fall off onto a mattress, and he loved Hathaway again having fun. Said, do it again. I said, how many times do you want me to do this? Do it again. I haven't got it quite right. But I enjoyed that. I think that scene was very exciting, particularly for the audience to see. When we finished, we went back to California. This was shot in Arizona, I think. The stuntman, one of the stuntmen, Bob Morgan was his name, wonderful golfer, wasn't paying attention. The train backed up and back and forth, knocked him off and cut his leg off. But he still became a great, still a great golfer with an artificial leg.
Now, The Good and Bad, the Ugly. How did your role in that movie come about?
I've often wondered how that happened. And then I read a book about Sergio Leone. They said, there's a stay away from him. He's the method actor, New York actor. And I thought he'd seen The Magnificent Seven. But that wasn't what he said. He went to see How the West Was Won. And in it, I threaten George Peppard, and he has his two little boys there. And as I was leaving, I said, so watch out for me. And I went like this to the kids. And that struck something in Leone's mind. He said, I want him to play Tuco in The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. And when I arrived, Leone was wearing suspenders and a belt. And I thought, he must be afraid his pants are going to fall down. So I said, can I have suspenders and a belt in my costume? He said, sure. And whatever I offered, he said, fine, that's fine. Whatever he didn't want, he cut. But he was an enterprising, bright director who had done a lot of research on the West. And has, if you look at it, there are many, many shots in that that are copied right out of Matthew Brady, who photographed a lot of the Civil War. There's a shot of a train coming into a station, and there's a man tied with his arms outstretched on the cow catcher in the front of the train. It says, spy, I'm a spy. I thought, how wonderful that he did that research and saw all that. He had a lot of Union soldiers standing there posing for a picture. He had, when I'm driving the horses with Clint Eastwood, and I say, there they are, the great rebel army, they'll take care of us. And the horsemen ride up, and the man goes like this and hits his arm, and it's blue. And the next shot, we're in a prison of war camp. Those are wonderful things that he created. The movie wasn't successful when it first came out, but it's become a kind of cult classic movie. I did one other one in which John Huston played in it. It was called Winter Kills. It's about the assassination of Kennedy, only it happens 10 years later. A remarkable movie.
I wanted to ask you, can you explain the popularity of Westerns?
Well, Westerns are kind of morality tales, the good and the bad, the black hats and the white ones. As a kid, I used to always imagine myself on the horses. I used to see the silent movies. That's a long time ago. The first movie with sound was The Jazz Singer. I spent 4 years in Texas going to school. It was like I was from Brooklyn. And it was like being put on another planet and reading about the West and understanding about the horses and the Indians and so on. I don't tend to romanticize it either. We did some terrible things to the Indians.
Mr. Wallach, why do you think you've been cast in so many different ethnic roles?
I think non-starring roles usually have fabric to them. They're rich. But I've played an Okinawan, a Greek jewel thief, a Mexican bandit, a half-breed warlord in Cambodia, Italians, many Italians, now Jews, playing old rabbis now. But each one brings a different flavor, a different culture, a different upbringing, a different genetic makeup. And it's wonderful to investigate and to probe into them. I don't have to, I went to one place in Nevada, in Utah. We were doing the Executioner's Song, and I met the man who played Gary Gilmore's uncle. He was a shoemaker. He had the biggest hands I ever saw. I said, don't tell me about the crime or anything. How do I fix shoes? And he taught me how to fix shoes. He also taught me archery. He was the archery champ of Utah. And I kept thinking, I'm so rich from having lived with these people in a little town in Italy, in Sicily, in Utah, in Cambodia, in Yugoslavia, in Canada, Mexico, England, Spain, Italy. I've had a wonderful, wonderful tour of the world, not as a tourist, not as a drop in and leave, but living there with these people, and it has enriched my life. I have to not deny my upbringing, my background. It's all done from that viewpoint, but I have to imagine what it would be like if I were an Okinawan and how I would play him. I'll never forget, I was playing in Tea House in London. I'd come out on stage and bow and bow, and one time I bowed, and there was Winston Churchill in the front row. And I thought, that's Winston Churchill. And he had a hearing aid, and he went like this. And I didn't know if he turned it off or turned it on. And all my Okinawan went out of my head, because all I wanted to know was, did he have it on or did he not have it on? But the different religions, different backgrounds, different orientations are all challenges to the actor. And he must pretend that he is this person.
And my last question for you is, how do you choose your roles? And is there one role that you were offered that you would turn down but wish you hadn't?
Once I turn it down, I never look back and say, oh, I wish I had and hadn't. The one experience I had, I mentioned before, about either Camino Reel or the movie, which
From Here to Eternity.
And I chose the play, not the movie. So 3 years later, I did my first movie, and it was by Tennessee Williams, so I didn't feel left out of anything. Whenever Frank Sinatra would meet me after that, he'd say, hello, you crazy actor. And I thought, that's a big compliment.
Rita Hayworth.
Yes. I was doing a film in Paris with Audrey Hepburn and Peter O'Toole. And on the weekends, I was invited to go down to Nice to shoot a movie for UNICEF called The Poppy Is Also a Flower. I played an old gangster. And there were the stars from all over California, all over England, so on. Trevor Howard, Peter O'Toole, Yul Brynner, Deborah Carr, Rita Hayworth. And I met Rita Hayworth. And I remember Rita Hayworth on a bed in Life magazine that drove every soldier in the war nuts because she's absolutely beautiful. And I, during the war, spent time in the officers' quarters in Juin-les-Pins between Cannes and Nice. And that house was where she married the Ali Khan. So that's the way we met, and we began to talk. And we'd have breakfast together while I was shooting this film, and she was shooting it. She was shy and lonely. And I felt such... first of all, I couldn't take my eyes off her because she was beautiful. And she was funny and I remember her dancing. That's all I remember, dancing. And then this terrible illness struck. And I get invitations to go to the Rita Hayworth memorial thing for Alzheimer's. And her daughter is so devoted to continuing that.
Yasmin.
What? That's a name, Yasmin.
Was she tall?
Rita? Well, I had just come from shooting with Audrey Hepburn, and at one point in the movie, I had to kiss her, and she was quite tall. And she said, Eli, I'll take my shoes off. I said, oh, I love you. And Rita was tall, a little taller, about my height. I'm shrinking now, so I don't keep track of my height. But Rita was beautiful and a listener. Very few people who are all famous listen, but she was a good listener.
Did you tell her how much you loved that picture of her on the
bed? Oh, yes. Well, I told her. So I forget what she said, but look, she was married to Orson Welles, to Ali Khan. I can't think who else. I never keep score of the marriages.
Especially in Hollywood.
Well, we don't live there, so I don't know.
Well, that'll do it. Thank you very much.
Pleasure.